isn't it odd that we meet people from time to time and you think, why don't you believe? Isn't it strange? Because very many of those folks that we come across like that, you look at them and they're quite well disposed towards faith and believing. Maybe they think it would be tidy, it would be good to believe, but they can't. They can't believe in a commitment sense. Maybe they would even say they believe in an intellectual approval sense. Mm. But when it comes to the commitment of faith, somehow they can't do that. Why is that? Then more positively, you sometimes come across someone whose faculties may be seriously impaired. Maybe they've had an accident and it's affected their cognitive skills. Maybe they were born congenitally, it arises, in such a way that they have a general learning difficulty or something of that sort. Any number of things like that, some acquired mental illness. And you wonder how on earth, in their situation, they could ever come to so clear, simple and profound a faith. But they have. How do you account for that? In fact, how do you account for these phenomena in general? That you come across people you'd have thought would have been saved by now and people you never thought would, but the salvation thing has, or just hasn't, happened for them. And you can't fathom it. Fancy that. Why is this? It's the case because of the doctrine of regeneration, which describes an early, basic, fundamental part of Christian experience. This is foundational Christian experience, the basis of faith that we work to with the group. It describes rather grandly in the manner of these things. It says, the total depravity of human nature in consequence of the fall and the necessity of regeneration. At least it used to until they revised it and put it in English. But sadly, you know how it is, I remember the old one. The necessity, the absolute necessity of the work of the Spirit of God to regenerate and give new life. What on earth is that going on about? We know what regeneration is about because we've watched Doctor Who, right? I'm messing with you. No, it's not exactly a help having watched Doctor Who with this one. That's not necessarily what it means in the Bible, to be frank. It's called in the Bible, and perhaps many of our translations do it like this. It's called being born again in John 3:3-8. The trouble we've got with it is this. In the church and in much Christian preaching, oh dear, this teaching does get a bit of a mauling. Mm. We tend to refer to what springs from it rather than to it itself. Do you know what I mean? We tend to refer to what comes of it rather than what it is. And that can get us in a tangle. Let me explain what I mean. Regeneration is one of the elements that is essential to the application of Christ's work of redemption to any saved human being. If it's going to become true for you, then you've got to be born again. The trouble is this, we tend to preach it like, go birth yourself again. And you just think about that and you see there's a problem. There are active elements in the application of redemption to any human being. We turn from sin and we turn to Christ, conversion. There's repentance, we're sorry for our sins and we repudiate it from our heart. There's sanctification. We, you know, if you by the Spirit put to death the desires of the flesh, you will live. We have an active part in those. Some measure. We need God's help. We need him working in and through us. We need the bionics of it all to sort of enable the basic movement. But we're making basic movement in those things ourselves. But regeneration is utterly passive. That is to say, regeneration in itself is 100% an act, a gift of God. And human passivity in this being born again is seen in at least two ways. Firstly, there's the choice of metaphor. You do not give birth to yourself, but you're passive in that process. You're engaged in it, you're tied up in it, you know, definitely you're in it, but you're passive in the process. And John 1:13 goes on and makes it explicit. We're born not of blood, nor of the will of man, but of God. So this is God doing it for us, which makes the things we're active in possible. Let me explain that and show you what I mean by way of looking at the Old Testament history of this. This is not some late patch-up job dreamt up when humans proved utterly incapable of turning from sin and trusting Christ. It's not that. It's something prophesied way back as part of the plan because of what we are like. You go back to Ezekiel chapter 26, chapter 36, verses 26 to 7. That's how I get confused. It's chapter 36 from verse 26 in Ezekiel. Speaking of a time when God's people will have wandered away into idolatry, and then have proved again that they haven't got in their hearts to walk with God because they're weak and they're frail and whatever. And they've gone off into captivity because things have gone wrong and God has sent them away. But after that, when he takes them from amongst all the nations and draws them back to himself, in Ezekiel 36:26, it says this, I will give you a new heart. And I will put a new spirit in you, the nefesh. Personality, the essential person that you are, I'll give you a new one. I will remove the heart of stone from your body, God, and give you a heart of flesh, a feeling sensitive to God heart. I'll put my spirit within you. I'll take the initiative and you will obey my statutes and carefully observe my regulations. That's what it takes for us to walk with God. We so need him that he needs to do this for us so we can then go on and walk with him. That's what it takes. And it needs to happen before we can respond positively to God's generally issued call. The gospel must be taken by the command of God to everybody without discrimination, right? We're to get out into the nations, into the world, the most likely, the most unlikely, and preach the gospel. But then we are dependent upon God to give new life. Don't we know that? How many times have you been with somebody, you've explained and explained and explained, and you think you've explained it really well? You probably have. We're dependent on the Spirit of God to give new life. Thank you.